Hello and welcome everybody to this new webinar of our EMWRE webinar series. I'm happy to be the moderator of today, a webinar about data management. I'm Charlotte Virion. I'm a guest professor at VUB and also work for VUB. Today, our agenda will be that I give you a short introduction and welcome to the webinar and our EMWRE project. Then Dr. Hans van der Kwast will give a presentation on sharing open data through spatial data infrastructures. And afterwards, there's Jürgen Everaerts, who will present the Terrascope platform, big data platform for remote sensing. And as usual, we have questions and answer session at the end. So please post all the questions that occur to you during the presentations. So what is the EMWRE project? It's a project that organizes an e-master in water resources engineering. The idea is to create a new generation of decision makers on water resources engineering and management in the MENA region. So the program will be blended learning, meaning there's online but also in-person master program using real-world case studies in an interdisciplinary project. It's also about using open software and data to analyze and solve problems. So the partners in this project are partly from the MENA region. So there is the Islamic University of Gaza in Palestine, the Al-Quds University in Palestine, the Mutar University in Jordan, and the University of Jordan in Jordan. But then there's also European partners such as the Free University of Brussels, IHC Delft, Institute for Water Education, and Yumina as well. So, of course, we want to thank the funding partners. So this project is part of the Erasmus Plus program of the European Union and the DUPC2 program. And for the international IHP, Open Water Network, UPWER, Fluios, and VITO. So please keep up to date with this project as well as the e-master. You can do this on our website that you see here, but also following us on social media. This is already the sixth webinar of our webinar series on using Internet of Things, remote sensing, and citizen science. It has been an exciting journey so far, and it will continue today with a webinar on data management. There are rules for the webinar. Basically, we welcome you to engage in the chat box, so by introducing yourself, where you come from, your interests, and to ask questions during the presentation that we will then collect and present during the question and answer session. The questions that are not being answered today will be put onto the platform for further discussion. We will also put recordings of this webinar and the presentation available on the EMWRE platform. And those that are interested in certificates, they can be requested and downloaded as well from our website. But you have to participate in all 8 webinars. There will be an invitation to register in the chat today. In the YouTube chat. So the most important is enjoy your webinar. And I will now introduce you to Hans van der Kwast, who is our first presenter. So he's a senior lecturer in geographic information systems, so GIS and data management at IHC Delft Institute for Water Education. He holds a PhD in physical geography from Utrecht University, and he has also worked previously at the Flemish Institute for Technological Research, VITO, in Belgium, where he participated in projects related to water quality modeling, land use change modeling, and the use of remote sensing for urban applications. He has been now at IIT Delft since 2012, and he's a great advocate of promoting the use of open source tools and open data by young professionals from the water sector. So he's also a lecturer of QGIS, an open software for GIS. And today he's going to present on sharing open data through spatial data infrastructures. Please, Hans, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Charlotte. So hello, everybody. In this webinar series, I normally have the role to host the technology. So it's a bit odd to today have both roles, but I think it works out fine. So as introduced, my presentation will be about sharing open data through spatial data infrastructures. It's an introduction to this concept. And last Saturday, it was Open Data Day, and therefore this presentation is a good match with that, where many people in the world shared their interests and their services on open data. So I'll start with this short animation, where you see the COVID amounts cumulative for the Netherlands from the first wave. And I made this in QGIS. Me as a citizen, I can make this easily with open source software, but of course I also need open data. So I used the municipality boundaries from the PayDoc Services plugin in QGIS, which gives me access to many open data sets for the Netherlands. And we're going to talk about these web services. And I have downloaded this file with cumulative amounts of COVID cases from the website of our health authority. And this sheet is updated every day at a fixed time. And then through open source software, I can create this animation. So open data is very useful and powerful. And if we want to solve challenges in the water sector, which are caused by pressure from climate change and population growth, we need to share a lot of data with each other. And traditionally, the different sectors are disconnected. But to solve these problems, we need to connect them and share data between the different sectors. So health has everything to do with drinking water, with sanitation, and economy is related to the environment and agriculture, and basically everything is connected to everything. And this still is a challenge to have the data flows between the different sectors, and that will be one of the topics in this presentation. But first, we have to define what open data is, and it has the same definition as open access publications or open education and open source software. It is about something that is open, not just to use it, but also to reuse it and redistribute it. And the only restriction that you can put on that is to attribute to the source where it comes from and to put a share alike license on it, which means that everybody who derives things from it should also put the same license on it, so it will always remain open. And in my opinion, publicly funded data are a public good, and they are there for the public interest and should be freely available to the maximum possible, because we all paid for it with tax money, and we have the right to get that data and also use it in our own tools and models as researchers, but also as citizens to check our data from the environment. But what are the benefits of open data? First of all, it reduces the duplicate efforts of data collection and processing, because a lot of data is used for different purposes. So if it's already collected by one organization or government authority and it's shared, the other one doesn't have to collect it. If we have open data, which is available for scientists in an easy way, we can link it to our models and tools that we use to understand, simulate, and predict the environment. It will also give public administrations, citizens, and businesses better services if more data is available, because we can do more advanced things and make decision support systems, for example. And it's important for innovation. if there's a lot of data available, then entrepreneurs and researchers, they can start new services and have business opportunities. And in the end, it will also lead to employment for youth especially, and extra income for the government because of the tax on employment and the tax of the services. And in the end, it leads to a greater democratic accountability if more data is available. But that's not what all countries want, but that's an important thing too. And in the end, it gives us better tools for the management of the common environment, and that's what we want. Now, if we look at the economic benefits, we can see from statistics that we get from different sources, like from the European Commission, that open data creates many jobs, and it reduces the cost for government. And that's mostly in transactions of data, because it's freely shared between different government agencies and with related organizations. And a lot of jobs are created by using open data in new services. We can also see here on the right side that there are benefits because of disaster risk reduction. For example, if we use remote sensing images and early warning systems, and all the data can be combined, that gives a lot of reduction in the cost for disasters, and we can evacuate maybe people on time, and also after the disaster improve the conditions easily if we know where things take place. So that all sounds great, but why is sharing then difficult? First of all, there's often an a priori suspicion of the quality of data from others. If it's from others, then yeah, we cannot really trust it. It's better to collect it ourselves. On the other hand, there's also the opinion that data, if we share it with others, that they will wrongly use it. This is especially the case for many data providers in certain countries, where they are afraid that others use it and use it in the wrong way, and therefore they lose face. These are the same people that also fear that other users will discover the poor quality of their data by sharing them. In the next slides, I'm going to explain that these reasons are not really valid, and there are solutions to that if you stick to good practice and you know why you are collecting and disseminating data. It's always easy to first start talking about the value of data, because if we share it as open data, then it means we cannot get money for it. But the thing is that there's a value chain. It's a bit like a farmer who has a cow, and the cow eats grass. And then when the farmer sells the cow to the butcher, it will be cut into pieces, and the price per kilo of the cow increases. And when the meat goes to a factory to be processed or to be packaged, the price per kilo increases further. When you buy it in the supermarket, we are further down the value chain of the meat of the cow, and you pay a much higher price per kilo. And if you go to a restaurant that is Michelin rated, then the food is prepared by a chef cook, and you pay the maximum price per kilo for the same cow. So the same is for data. Raw data has a low value because it needs validation. You need to aggregate it, turn it into information, analyze it, combine it with other data to add knowledge, provide it in a useful way to the end user as services on the web, on mobile phones, and aggregate even different services to get better services for citizens, but also for governments and for private sector. And you can ask a price for it if it's on this side of the spectrum, but if it is just raw data, it doesn't have much value. There's also a cost of selling data, because in fact, you're running a shop when you're selling data. It means that you need to take care of people who illegally steal from your shop by making copies of the data. So you need to have licenses, you need lawyers, and you need to track people. There's an administrative cost, because when you issue the license, you want to know who bought it, and they want to be also in touch with you if there are issues with the data. And if you run a shop, you also need to do marketing, to promote what data you have in your shop. This all comes at a cost and needs people to run the shop. There's also strategic risks of selling data. I could ask you, do you pay for digital products such as music or videos? Nowadays, less people will say that they do that because they have Netflix and Spotify. But before that, a lot of people were just copying MP3s and CDs and VCDs and DVDs. Because once a product is digital, people are less willing to pay because it's so easy to copy from others. That's the same with data. So if you want to sell data, yeah, you should not be surprised when other people just copy that same data. Another thing that can happen is that competitors or communities might already be supplying that data for free. An example is OpenStreetMap. If you want the roads in your country, I know from my work that in some countries you need to go to the mapping agency and then you buy the roadmap. But you could also just go to openstreetmap.org and download all the roads in your country, as well as other topographic data that you need in vector format. So you need to be careful when you sell data because it can be a strategic risk. And to determine what data you need to sell and what you need to disseminate for free, as open data, you need a data policy where you thought about the value chain of the data, about your customers, about if there was tax money paid already on the data. And then you choose the license that you want to put on the data. So a data policy is always linked to the business model and the value chain that is applicable to your data. And some countries have good data policies. Here are some examples. Rwanda and INSPIRE, the INSPIRE Directive of Europe, which basically says that government data should be shared openly as much as possible. And therefore, our data is available in different portals. Back to the topic of SDI, spatial data infrastructures. Traditionally, you work on your own computer, maybe the computer from which you are watching now this webinar. You have your GIS software. You have the data on a USB stick or a portable drive from somebody, and you load it into your GIS. And then you process the data, and you write it again to disk. And then if somebody needs it, you make a copy and you give a disk to the person, or you put it on a cloud service like Dropbox to share it. That is not the proper and modern way of working, although it's still important that you can do that. But the spatial data infrastructure goes a step further. It connects all these GISs that people have to a common infrastructure, which allows for sharing of spatial data, the metadata, we're going to talk about that, but also about documents, and also to know each other through like a social media, where people who have data available on the infrastructure also have their profile, their picture, their contact, etc. And in that way, if the sectors that I had on one of my first slides start sharing their data through a spatial data infrastructure, and much of that data is freely available, entrepreneurs and researchers can use that data to develop apps and services and add value to it and can even monetize it, have models running, or develop decision support systems that, again, can feed back to the government who can use this and maybe not have the experts in-house to develop that. So this can be developed by research institutions. In the 90s, a lot of data initiatives were there to share data through a database. But the database is really a humiliation for the term spatial data infrastructure. It is an infrastructure, the database only part of it. I'll show that later in my slides. But an SDI goes further. It's about discovery of data. So a search engine where you look for rivers in Rwanda, and it should give you then back the rivers that are in Rwanda. So it's the why and where question. You should be able to visualize the data before you start using it. So it needs an interactive map, infographics, some real-time data maybe. Then you also want to evaluate the quality, and you do that by looking at the metadata and linked documents. So an SDI should also provide that functionality. And eventually you want access to the data. You might want to just download files and put it in your desktop GIS, but you might want to have a live connection to the original source of the data, or you want to serve it through the web. And it all needs to link to the same data sources. So we're not working with copies, but we keep the same data source. So it's about working smarter and not harder. And it's an infrastructure comparable to a road. It sounds ridiculous if I say that if you go from your house to university or to your work, that you pave your own road. The road network is a common investment which allows a reliable movement of vehicles. And there are some rules, but you're free to choose if you want to use your bicycle, your horse, or public transport. Same with data infrastructure. There are some standards. We're going to talk about that. There is it's all about reuse of data, but also of skills, capabilities, and investments, of sharing data and knowledge, and learning from each other what the best way to do that is, and increase the reuse of data. And as with roads, if the infrastructure is bad, has problems, then you get stuck. It's still not so easy because there are some speed bumps, like on a real road, that we need to handle. And the first thing is that, yeah, if you travel a lot, with COVID times, we don't travel a lot anymore, but you remember from those days that everywhere you go, you have different power plugs, and that, it's mission impossible to let all countries standardize that we all use one power plug. So the main solution is to use the universal plug, and that works in every country. Now, the same we do with an SDI. We don't say everybody has to use the same file types or database or whatever software, but we say we make that universal plug. And that universal plug is an API, an application programming interface, and it communicates between the client and the server. The client sends a question to the API. For example, give me the rivers of Rwanda in that and that format, in that area, for that time. Then the API will ask that to the server. The server gives it back to the API, and the API sends it to the client. The client is a piece of software. It's a mobile phone app. It's a web browser, etc. And this communication takes place over HTTP, very often using a REST interface, which stands for representational state transfer. And these are just URLs sent between these different actors. These standards, they are from the OGC, if they're open standards, the Open Geospatial Consortium. And they are currently developing new ones, but these are still very active. Because of time, I'm not going to handle all of them. But if you want to download or use vectors in surfaces, the point lines and polygons, you use the web feature surface. If you just want a rendered picture, you use the WMS, the web map service. This is for the catalog services for the web. This is to share models, web processing service, so processes. Web coverage service, this is for the raster data. Then we have tiles, and there are some other ones too. But you can find them all here. There's also standards for sensors and for citizen science, for example. And there's also Python implementations. You can find them in your GIS. This is a screenshot from QGIS where you find them here. And I'm going to give an example from the WINS system from UNESCO IHP. And here we see QGIS. And I'm going to open a connection to the GeoNode. That's an SDI stack. And I add a new connection. Just need that URL. And then I connect. That takes a bit of time, and then it loads all the layers, and I'm going to load here one of those layers as a WFS about the volume of collected wastewater in Arab states in 2013. And when I add it, it loads from the internet, and I get all the polygons in that data set, and I can have the attributes with it and use that further in my analysis. So the software that's used here is GeoNode, and an SDI needs a database. In open source, we use most often PostGIS, PostgreSQL. You need a server to publish it on the web. So in GeoNode, we often use GeoServer, but you can also use QGIS server or another one. An interface to visualize. There's Django in GeoNode for the web interface, and open layers to serve the layers on the web, the map layers interactively, and the catalog services for the web are needed also in an infrastructure like that. Now, just a last slide on metadata, because people often don't want to share their data because they're afraid people are going to do wrong things with it. Well, imagine that you're in a restaurant and you frequently visit it and you get this cheese platter in the end. And you remember that there was one very nice cheese that you want to have again. And there was also this nasty one, which smells like your socks after 3 weeks of fieldwork in the tropics. But you get this platter without the labels with the names of the cheese. So you have to try them all with a big risk to take a piece of the one that smells like the socks of the fieldwork. So if there's a label on the cheese, then you know, hey, the nice one was this camembert from Algeria, and it has this fat content and so many grams and an expiry date and a brand name. So the user should, in this metaphor, be able to make the right choice based on the information that is presented. And that information that is presented with this cheese is the metadata. So producers of data should just be clear about what it is, and then the user can determine to eat the cheese or to leave it. Now, because of Open Data Day, I added a new section on gisopencourseware.org with a lot of data resources that are open for you to use in GIS. So have a look at that and use it in your own applications. This was my last slide, so I'm putting back Charlotte on the stream.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. The presentation was very nice, very illustrative. The examples were nice, made me laugh more than once. Yes, there's a lot of open data available and a lot you can do with it. So don't hesitate to ask all your questions you might have on this in the chat so that we can ask them to Hans van der Kwast afterwards. And now let me introduce you to our second speaker, Jürgen Everaert. He holds a master degree in physics, but has been active in the field of Earth observations since the 1990s. So during all this time, he has been involved in projects and in the program management in photogrammetry, inertial position and attitude determination, LiDAR processing, hail drone platforms for Earth observation. So a lot of knowledge on Earth observation there. At this moment, he's managing the Terrascope platform development, which provides easy access to Copernicus Sentinel data and products. And this is also what his presentation today is going to be about. Please, Jürgen, you can join me here and start your presentation.
Thank you, Charlotte, for the introduction. Hello, everybody. I will be talking about Terrascope as a big data platform for remote sensing, but to get to the big data, we need to think about the Copernicus program of the European Union, and especially about the Sentinel satellites that are built by the European Space Agency to provide data on the Earth across the globe. In a very persistent way. There's currently 8 satellites of the Sentinel constellation active. There's 2 Sentinel 1s, 2 and 3. There's a Sentinel 5B satellite and the Sentinel 6 satellite. Now let me explain. Sentinel 1 is a radar satellite, and the good thing about a radar satellite is that it can see through the clouds. So whenever it passes over, you have a guaranteed observation of the swath that it is covering. And it is covering the whole Earth in a systematic way every 6 days. So in the same viewing geometry, your spot on Earth will be viewed every 6 days. It has a spatial resolution of about 10 meters. So the smallest object that you can recognize is the size of a house. So it is not very high spatial resolution, but it is a high temporal resolution mission. The same applies to the Sentinel-2 satellite, which is an optical satellite. It looks at the Earth in the visual and infrared range. And by doing so, it records natural color images, but also colors in the infrared that are very useful in, for instance, water or vegetation monitoring. The Sentinel-2 has the same kind of resolution, 10 meters about, and it passes over in the same geometry every 5 days. Sentinel-3 is a global observation satellite, not only looking at the land masses, but also at the oceans at a lower resolution of 300 meters, but a daily coverage or close to daily coverage. Sentinel-5P looks at the atmosphere and monitors the concentration of trace gases like nitrogen dioxide, carbon monoxide, and methane, and so forth. And then Sentinel-6 is a topography mission that uses LIDAR, laser pulses, to measure the altitude of the sea level. And that is, of course, very important for global change. Now, this program in the mid of the last decade, and it is currently already guaranteed to work until 2030. And if you look at the timeline in the bottom, you see that the second generation of these satellites will be appearing by the end of the decade. So it is going to run a lot longer still. The good thing about this is that it is not just a very performant constellation, but it is also providing open and free data to everyone. So it's not concentrating, it's not just for European citizens, it's a data source for the whole Earth. Right, just to show you what it looks like, this is the radar image. The radar will send out a pulse of radiation to the Earth collect the reflected radiation. And you see the built-up areas are bright because they reflect radar radiation very well. The bluish line that you see across the image is a canal. Water tends to absorb the radar radiation, and the fields that you see across the image are grayish tints because vegetation is not a very good reflector, and besides it moves, and so radar radiation is not so reflection is not so strong. Color image is a lot easier to understand. You can see the fields, you can see the built-up area. You understand that there is a canal there. You even see that there is an algal bloom on the canal, in the top of the canal. This image was recorded in the summer of last year, where we had very high temperatures and so risk of algal blooms. So this is what the data looks like, and there's a lot of it. The Copernicus, the Sentinel satellites provide about 18.5 terabytes of data every day, which is all published on the open access hub hosted by ESA. So across the world, 18.5 terabytes of data is published. In Belgium, of course, it's a very small country. It is greatly reduced. We only have about 20 gigabytes of data a day that is recorded above the Belgian area. And I'm using the Belgian area because the telescope is a Belgian platform. But actually, we hold Sentinel-2, the optical data, for all of the European Environment Agency countries. That is from Iceland in the north to Turkey in the south southeast. Now, radar data or satellite data is very nice, but it's not usable as it is provided on the Open Access Hub. It is in all kinds of formats. It is zipped to make it more compact and easily transferable. But for the user, it is tedious. We have seen that lots of potential users of satellite data are turned away because they don't want to do all of that work of pre-processing data. So, and on Terrascope, we have unpacked the data and we have converted it into cloud-optimized UTIF, which means that you can integrate the data directly into a GIS product like a QGIS. And having the satellite data is nice, but really what you want is you want to derive products from that. And so we calculate vegetation indicators and we will be calculating water indicators as well based on that data and from 20 gigabytes of data, calculating the vegetation indicators and the coherence time series coherence data adds another gigabyte of data. So it's only one in 20 reduction of volume, but on the other hand, it adds information to the data. Very important, the data on Terrascope is findable via a catalog service because you don't want to go scroll lots of folder structures to look for your data. And more information can be found on the Terrascope website. How does these derived products look like? We have vegetation indicators. LAI is a leaf area index. It's really a measure of biomass. So the greener area, the more biomass is present in this agricultural field. FAPAR is a measure of photosynthetic activity. So the greener, the more photosynthesis is happening on the field. F-cover is how much of the soil is covered by vegetation. So that is another measure of vegetation. And NDVI is a very well-known indicator of vegetation. It captures the health of your vegetation. And by combining these four, you can have a very good insight of what this vegetation is actually doing. And the six-day coherence is derived from the radar image, and it looks a bit fuzzy. But it is very useful because it really documents how much the area looks alike the previous overpass 6 days before. So if you have bright areas like the city in the bottom right corner, it stays bright because it is stable and nothing too much happens. In the rest, you see darker hues because vegetation changes. But wherever you see a yellow field, it's probably bare soil because it's already harvested. And so when you see a field flip from dark to bright, you know that something discrete has happened. For instance, it's been harvested. But data and products are nice, but it's not more than that. You can look at it. It is interesting, and sometimes domain experts will recognize stuff. In the left image, you see this round feature in the field, and that may be the sign of prehistoric constructions that keep influencing the vegetation growth. On the right side, you see this linear structure in the field. And that is probably drainage installed in the field, but these are just suppositions. From looking at the images, you see that there's something there, but you really need a domain expert to understand what is going on. And of course, the real value, as Hans has said, is in extracting the information. For instance, and that is the big power of the Sentinel satellites, how does an object change over time? And how does that relate to the properties of the object? Now, look at the field that I've drawn in the bottom, and the indicators, the LAI and the NDVI indicator that we've calculated for that field, and you see there's a clear drop in the beginning of July 2020 in these indicators, and they both rebounce and go upwards again. Now, if you're not familiar with this kind of information, you may think that probably the field was harvested and something else was put on the field, and it started growing very rapidly, and that's why this is happening. Now, if you look at the images themselves, you see that the drop in vegetation indicator is really due to the fact that the area was cloud covered. And that most of the field was in the shadow of the cloud, and so the measure is really not reliable, because a few days later it is totally green again as it was. And that is why we like to integrate Sentinel-1 information, which has a guaranteed observation because it looks through the couch, together with the Sentinel-2 information that is optical. And by combining both, we can reconstruct the curve as shown on the bottom. And that curve is representative for a certain type of crop. It's, in this case, it starts growing in June and is harvested by the end of by September or the end of September. And the shape of this curve is useful for agronomers to determine which kind of crop it is and whether or not it is healthy. Now, if you want to use big data, of course, you could download it. But I've shown you that it is about lots of data, and you will be spending a lot of time downloading data, waiting for the download to complete, and then have to pay for more disks to store all that data on. So don't do that. Use a cloud platform, because the cloud platforms that are present have lots of data already. They're stored locally, you can access them directly and don't have to wait for downloads. In many cases, they also offer processing capacity, so you can work on the satellite data without having to download it. And there's plenty of examples like Google Earth Engine or Sentinel Hub or the different DIAS platforms organized by the European Commission to promote the use of the Copernicus satellites. But there's also Terrascope. And the Terrascope platform has different services like a catalog to make the data findable, like this time series service where you can simply draw a polygon and you get back the indicator of your choice to see how vegetation has changed. We have these OGC web services, as Hans was mentioning, to integrate the data directly into your GIS application. And there's also OpenEO. Now, I'm not going to talk about OpenEO a lot, but OpenEO is really an additional layer between the platforms that host the data and yourself. By using OpenEO, you can write scripts exploiting the data that is independent of the platforms. So you don't have to rely on one platform. You can write something that is transferable between platforms, and one platform would go out of operation. You're not stuck. Using OpenEO is very important. And we also offer processing capacity. We have virtual environments that work close to the data in different forms. We have the JupyterLab interface, which is really a Python interface where you can use different cells to split up your processing. You can add comments to that. And it is directly interfacing with the data on the Terrascope platform. The same applies to the virtual machines, where you have a user interface and, for instance, the QGIS desktop already pre-installed, so you can use the power of QGIS without having to download the data. And finally, and I'm coming close to the end, what is it used today? What is it used for today? We have the Flemish Water Management Agency uses this to check the water quality of the water services that they have under their supervision. And we can determine the concentration of chlorophyll in the water using just a Sentinel-2 satellite. And by looking at the distribution of the chlorophyll or the elevation of the levels, they know whether or not the water is still healthy or needs treatment. On the top right, the crop map is the example of reducing the data to an ultimate form. We've used the whole year of 2020 of observations of Sentinel-1 and 2 to determine for every agricultural parcel which crop is growing on it. In Belgium, we can check that with registrations for the agriculture ministry, and we know that we can do this with an accuracy of about 86%. Air quality monitoring is possible as well. And finally, global cover maps. We've used the Terrascope platform to create global cover at uniform global land cover maps of 2015 to 2019 at 100 meter resolution. And so that is the power of the Terrascope platform. It holds lots of data, but it is also a very powerful processing system, and it is free to use for all. If you want to use it, you can simply register. You can have a Jupyter Lab environment. You can have a virtual machine. And so I invite you to explore it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Again, a very nice presentation. Very, very good to see all the potential there is in the Copernicus mission. And also, I fully agree to promote using satellite images online and working with them online instead of downloading them. So yes, go ahead, explore these platforms, and the Terrascope platform is one I also use and can only promote it as well. So please also post all the questions that you have so that we can answer them now. And there's a first one here from Derek Mabaga. Most of the satellite data have short span period, like 7 to 10 years. And to perform hydrological modeling, you need data with longer span period, more than 20 years. Why satellite have shorter periods?
There's very practical reasons. The satellites need to be able to navigate around the Earth. Of course, staying in their orbit is easy because it's an inertial way of orbiting, but they need to avoid other satellites every now and then, so they need propulsion, and that is expended over the time of 7 to 10 years. The good thing about the Copernicus system is that they have replacement satellites that will be launched before, so you have a guaranteed very long time span of observations that will come. So today, from 2015 onwards, but that will expand into the 2030s. So this long span period will be guaranteed. Yes.
Thank you. So another question from Precious Tuason: can these systems be incorporated in industry that needs to have close monitoring on wastewater quality to a treatment plant and its effluent? On hourly monitoring, or is it impractical? Thank you.
That's a question related to the OGC standards just posted, but I think we both can answer that. So there are standards for communicating between sensors in the field and in places where you want to have that data for further processing. So these standards, there are standards for sensors, for remote sensors, for all kinds of transmissions. So it really depends on what the situation is, and not so much on what type of data for the sensor and for the system. It doesn't matter too much, but you need to think about the temporal frequency, about the distribution of your network, about what do you want to communicate between the sensor and where you further process it or want to display it on a mobile phone or on a web service. Maybe Jurgen has something to add.
Yeah, definitely hourly monitoring from space is very expensive. There are companies that do that. The Planet, for instance, has constellations that guarantee an hourly overpass across the world, but they need to be paid for that. So you need to expend a lot of money. And again, if there's any clouds, you won't see the water, so you won't have any monitoring. So in this case, I would say go for in-situ sensors. It's a lot easier.
Thanks a lot. Juan Ramirez asks, how can we create an account to use the Terrascope platform? Are there tutorials available? Can you give us an example of the resolution of the products? For example, NDVI, land use maps, water quality.
Well, creating an account, it's simple. You go to the website, you register. It's on the top right of the homepage. And once you have a registration, you have an account that you can use for the Terrascope platform. You can then use it to download data, but also to explore the virtual research environments. There's lots of documentation available in a documentation portal. We've done a few webinars last year to explain more of that, so you could look that up in the news section. The resolution of the products is 10 meters about, and so on. So there's lots of information, but I think it's too much to answer now. I'm sorry.
Yes, you can also find the link to the Terrascope platform. We share it through the platform, but we can also share it here so that you can explore yourself a bit.
Yeah.
The next question goes to Hans van der Quast from Mansoor Rahman. What are the best practices, standards to follow regarding consistent geospatial data product sharing? For example, also for the metadata, we use Dublin Core metadata elements.
Yeah, that's a very good question. From my own experience, stick to the OGC standards and APIs that are also currently being developed. They are joining forces with the W3C consortium, which allows all of us to use the internet with different browsers. So what we see is that the geo domain is moving closer to the web development domain. So you can't go wrong to follow those standards. If it's about the metadata, it really depends. If you are in a government, an authority, or in the European Union, you have to stick to their templates and their standards. If you are setting up an SDI for your organization, it is much more practical to come up with what works well for you. And through these catalog services for the web, it can still be communicated. So if you want to use, for example, the Inspire metadata fields, then the data provider has to fill in hundreds of fields. And probably if you are just an organization providing data and not into authorities, that's a lot of work. And even you have a high risk that people in your organization are not very willing to fill in all those fields. I don't know, at Vito, do you have a spatial data infrastructure? I know when I was working there, we were talking about that.
Well, there's several. We have different research units, and they all like to use their own spatial data infrastructure because they're working on different subjects. It's more logical to do that than to try to make something universal that is working 25% for you and 75% against you. Yes, we do have SDI, but I'm certainly not able to tell you which one to go because I don't know your situation.
So it has to stay practical and tailored to your own situation, I would say.
Thanks a lot. Gorgon Formiga Johnson asks, what resolution improvement of the satellite images data can we expect in the future and when?
Well, in the Copernicus system, the second generation of these satellites will have an improved resolution, but that's going to go down to probably 5 meters instead of 10 meters, but it's never going to go to less than 1 meter because it is simply physically very difficult to keep on covering the Earth every 5 days at that kind of resolution. The high-resolution satellites that are available today will make snapshots across the world, but never do consistent observation of the whole Earth. So it's very likely that there's going to be a pretty moderate improvement, but you need to think about these satellites as especially interesting and in the temporal domain, where you can really follow up evolutions very easily as compared to orthophotos produced by an aircraft once a year at a 20 centimeter resolution.
Yes, thank you. Juan Tran Yok says, my research focuses on one flood risk assessment based on a different source. How can I develop a data collection platform to show and visualize my research free of charge? Data storage domain fees. I guess that goes to you, Hans.
Yes, it really depends on what you want to do. And for free, even there are a few options. So if you want to, if you mean with data collection, you have field data collection, you can use QField or the input app. And they the input app, for example, connects to a cloud service, Mergin, and you can connect your QGIS to the Mergin cloud. And that means that everybody who is joining your data collection project can also use it like that. You can also export your data from QGIS with QGIS to web. Then you will have a leaflet website or open layers that you can put on a server. And there are some free hosting organizations, but that would be a bit difficult, and that's not the most professional way, and you have to also take care of security. There are also cloud services available. So I think there's QGIS Cloud, and there is there are a few others that are similar. You have to look for that. Also with MapTiler, you can have your own data set as a tile server. They all have probably freemium business models where some basic functionality is free, but if you want to do the real stuff, it gets more expensive. Let's see if there's another question. Sorry, I have to multitask a bit. I didn't see another question for Jürgen, but there is one here for me from Vinel. Let me see if I can find it back to comment on that a bit. It's about the layer that I connected to QGIS. Well, the layer was just an example. I don't know anything about that layer that I connected. I just wanted a layer from the MENA region because that's the scope of this project. And I wanted to use VINS because that is a great example of an SDI that is accessible for all of you. And maybe that also answers the previous question, that if you think your data is relevant for others, you can also upload it to the WINS system. WINS uses GeoNode, and the link is already in your chat. And with GeoNode, you can upload your data and set the security settings for who can use it and who can't, or give access to different groups. And then through QGIS, you can simply, with the URL of WINS, connect to the infrastructure and get those layers into your project. So that's very useful. And there are many other SDIs that work in the same way. If it's GeoNode, you just need to use the GeoNode function in QGIS with the top domain URL of the service. But if it's, for example, services that that Jürgen showed, then you can use the OGC links in QGIS that I showed in the screenshot. So you can make a WMS link or a WFS or WCS to get that data into QGIS. And if you want to know more about that data that I showed, then just go to WINS and check out that data layer.
Thanks a lot. I guess there's a lot of things you can try out and check out with all the open available layers, data, and satellites. So I hope you enjoyed the webinar as much as I did. And thanks a lot for your questions and your contribution. Thanks a lot, Hansen Akrast and Jürgen Everett, for your wonderful presentations and very clear answers. And yeah, we can close this webinar for today. See you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.